Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Tata Communications Analyst Day webinar. We are joined today by our MD and CEO, Mr. Amur Lakshminarayanan, and Prathibha Advani, CFO. We will commence today's call with presentation from Lakshmi, who will share his views on overall business and company strategic direction. At the end of presentation, we will open the forum for Q&A session. Interested participant may click on raise hand icon next to their name in the participants pane on Webex application to join Q&A queue. The participant may click this option during the presentation itself to ensure they find a place in the queue. Upon announcement of their name, the participant will be unmuted by the host and they can start asking the question. Before we get started, I would like to remind everyone that some of the statements made or discussed on the conference call today may be forward-looking in nature and must be viewed in conjunction with the risks and uncertainties we face. A detailed statement and explanation of these risks are included in our annual filing, which you can locate on our website, www.tatacommunications.com. The company does not undertake to update these forward-looking statements publicly. With that, I would like to invite Lakshmi to share his views. Over to you, Lakshmi. Lakshmi, you are on mute. Sorry.
Thank you, Vipul. Hello, everyone. Very pleased to meet you all. And we had mentioned during our the year-end call that we would have this session explaining our strategy. What I would cover today is a context of the market, what we have learned from our customers, and what their views and where what their directions are. You will see also some explanation on how we see the overall market and its size. And you would see within that what is our strategy, where our focus will be, and how we are setting our priorities for the medium to the long term of our future. So that is what we would cover during the session today. Next slide, please. So what are the customer drivers? So when we talk to our customers, there are five key themes that are emerging. In the world of digital, you might say Industry 4.0, in many, many other industries, these five themes stand out across various businesses. The first one is, you know, people feel more confident of leveraging digital for growth. They don't see digital as a disruption. Yes, in the beginning period, yes, there was worries about disruptors coming, disintermediators coming, and so on. But now people feel that digital they can use for their growth. And borderless growth is one of our solid themes, and it's playing out quite nicely in the context of the current pandemic as well. The second key theme is, how do you use digital for delivering a superior customer experience? And also boosting the product innovation within the company. So digital is all about, you know, how do you deliver everything real time, understanding the customer, and deliver a superior experience. So this is not just in B2C, we see that in the B2B world as well. And similarly, in the product innovation, where people are trying to embed more intelligence into the product, and leverage IoT to see how they can deliver a better service, after sales, and so on. And we have our solutions and offerings that addresses some of that, and you would see some of those examples. The third key theme that you see is, and this is an age-old theme, how do we use digital for productivity and efficiency? And a lot more focus on how do I use AI, how do I use automation to drive and deliver those efficiencies. The fourth is building agility. Digital and agile go hand in hand, and how do you build agility? And from our point of view, you know, our the network architecture that we implement for our customers, agile, flexible architecture. And we will probably briefly touch upon that. And the fifth one is about managing risk. You know, again, in the world of digital, these 2 points of views around risk that we talk to our customers about. One is digital brings with it a myriad of technologies, whether it's the network, whether it's the cloud and security and so on. How can we stitch all of these together to deliver a seamless and end-to-end future-proofed, secure, robust architecture and therefore services to our customers? So that is one way to manage risk. The second way is about our security offerings that, for example, our IT network comes with DDoS embedded in that. Many providers don't do that. And on top of that, we offer a secure security overlay when we deliver a network transformation for our customers. So these are the things that we help our customers. But these are the five broad themes in the world of digital that we hear from our customers. Next slide, please. So in my view, digital is about data, applications, and connectivity. And it's like a three-legged stool. And the point of view that I have been developing in the last 6 months since I joined this company is connectivity has been a sort of poor cousin and has got a short shrift in the digital. Everybody recognizes that to deliver the digital transformation, the connectivity, cloud, security, all of them are equally important. But somehow the importance associated with that is not very pronounced. And therefore, one of our jobs, one of our mandates is to explain this importance to the customers and also take our rightful position within the enterprise, given that connectivity is an important part of our customers' digital transformation. Next slide, please. So what is our opportunity landscape? Internally, we also look at this as the economics of data. There's an explosion of data, as we all know. But the question is, where is the money going? And the slide, as you would see, we've broken down into the six broad segments. And each of the segments, as you can see, is in triple-digit billion number, barring the voice segment, which we all know is declining at 7 to 8 billion numbers. I would particularly pay more attention as we go along on the next slide with the next generation connectivity piece. But in all of the previous slide, please, on the all of those six that we saw here, we have all our robust offerings, be it mobility, IoT, collaboration, in the next gen connectivity, the cloud, edge, and security. NetFoundry, which is placed in the one might call the edge, as well as the cloud app or zero trust. It's a software-based ability to spin up a network on the fly. And voice, of course, both enterprise voice as well as the PSTN voice that we provide in our collaboration services. Next slide, please. So if you look at the enterprise network spend, and I would draw your attention to left-hand side bottom bar chart, $145 billion is the enterprise network spend globally. And the one below that you see for 2023, $254 billion, is the enterprise's spend on mobile, which is all the internet as well as the mobile access of enterprise users who are accessing and consuming the enterprise resources, be it on data center or the cloud or the collaboration. What you see on the right hand side is the breakup of that 145 billion number. And while the 145 number between 2018 to 2023 isn't slated to change, and I might have a different viewpoint on that, but this is the data. But this 145 billion world is not going to be static. It is going to churn. It is going to transform. And therein lies our opportunity. And just to give you an example of within that 145 billion world is the MPLS and the Ethernet and different forms of connectivity that exist, including internet And now with software-defined WAN and associated services coming on board, this entire space is going to transform and change. While the overall, the headline number is shown to be not changing, we believe there is going to be a substantial amount of activity in this space, essentially driven by people's movement to cloud. So one of our customers, the global customer headquartered in the US, is they are a tier one suppliers to automotive companies. And that CEO remarked to me that had they not done the network transformation alongside with their cloud transformation, their ability to have reacted for the current pandemic in an agile way would have been extremely difficult for them. So the point being, when customers move from data centers to cloud, and cloud, there are different manifestations of the cloud, as they do that, they need a very agile network to go with that, and to be able to cope with those changes that the customers are making. As well as when the customers do M&A as well, the network needs to be agile enough to be able to absorb a different heterogeneous network that comes into a company when they do the M&A. And all of these we have seen through network transformation, and we have some excellent case studies there that we talk to our customers about. So that's one important point to note. Next slide, please. So this is still talking about that 145 billion world and the 254 billion world. The 145 billion world, you can see that is within the enterprise ecosystem, the OTT and the cloud service provider ecosystem, and then the service provider ecosystem that we see. And that's entirely the 145 billion. So when we talk to enterprises, them connecting to the data centers, their factories, their branches, and all of that, or if they are breaking out to cloud, all of that is part of the 145 billion world. The one you see below the 254 billion world, which is currently 237, is all mobile users of enterprises. So when they are consuming the enterprise resources or accessing applications of enterprises, and they are connecting through their broadband, that is the space that is spent. And similarly, when they are also doing e-commerce activities and consuming that, or they are consuming for their infotainment through YouTube or other things, those are all the spend that goes into the 254 billion world. As of now, we play in that 145 billion world, and we do not play in the 254 billion world. And I think, and I explained the 145 billion world, the upside for us is the churn and the transformation that is happening within that world and how we can participate in that. And in the 254 billion world, there are some opportunities that we are spotting, and we will develop some of those offerings in those spaces as well. Next slide, please. So what are our key pillars? And we have identified some of these as key pillars based on, what is the headroom available? Can it scale? Can it scale profitably? What is the CapEx intensity involved? And those are all the questions that went into it for our discussion and evaluation. And we believe we have a comprehensive set of pillars and solutions that we can take to the market. So the Move and IoT platform, you already are aware, it's about, how we bring together our MVNE capability, our eSIM platform capability to deliver an IoT solution, which for a large auto OEM, our eSIMs are rolled out into their cars, which enables the manufacturer to sell the car anywhere, to be able to bootstrap, connect securely, and we take care of all the hotspots so that it can connect dynamically multiple providers and so on across different many countries. The same solution, the platform is used for airlines, for example, when the airline crew travels from country to country, we have at least three airlines who are customers of us who's using this platform solution with them. The next pillar is the network plus plus that we talk about. So network plus plus means all our core network as well as the security overlay that we talk about. And that's a key pillar for our network transformation. The InstaCC is the cloud-based platform that we position for both customer experience as well as the employee experience that we offer. Collaboration is a full suite of services that we offer for enterprises, employees to collaborate more effectively, be it on Teams, be it on Cisco, be it on any of the platforms, and associated connectivity services as well as the platform that we deliver is our key pillar. Media services is a very unique thing, and I will probably touch upon that briefly in a subsequent slide, that we deliver a seamless and dedicated video connect for both the consumption as well as the distribution network for many broadcasters as well as the sporting federations. MMX is essentially the omni-channel messaging, A2P messaging service that we offer. So these are some of the key pillars that we have, and we have other solid offerings around, as I said, cloud, security, all of it, the capabilities goes into that. So for example, our Video Connect includes some edge cloud capabilities. We do offer cloud as a standalone capability, largely in India, and security overlay, as I talked about, has over the top of the network. CDN gets embedded alongside with MOVE similarly. So we have all of these other capabilities which can get embedded into these key pillars when we deliver the solution to our customers. Next slide. So all of those six pillars and offerings that we talked about addresses the current capabilities. And in the as a post-COVID scenario and what we saw with customers, I see the secure connected digital experience as a family or a broad team of solutions that we are launching. And this will go some way to address the 254 billion market to begin with in a limited way. Right? So the first one is a secure connected digital workplace, which is enabling enterprise employees to work from anywhere. This is what I said is probably a work from home 2.0 solution. And we have multiple patterns of solution, a more traditional VPN and a secure VOTM kind of solution, or our new zero trust solution based on Net Foundry plus VDI, which has seen some very, very good results in terms of not only providing the security that enterprises look for, but also being able to accelerate the performance over the internet, right, which is a very unique thing. The second is about the customer experience platform. How can we help our both the B2C customers largely to bring or deliver the next generation of e-commerce for them? So more a video collaboration and a video commerce enabled platforms for them. So that is what is the customer experience platform. So and that we are piloting with a couple of customers as we speak. The third is still a work in progress in terms of how do we help the B2B ecosystem connectivity for our customers. So those are some of the new solutions. The first two, the first one is already launched, and we have helped hundreds of customers already. The second one is under pilot, and the third one is still work in progress. Next slide, please. Before I go to this, I just wanted to give you an example of how we view the customers. So if you imagine a manufacturing customer, a manufacturing OEM, they are looking at how do they improve their customer buying journey? How can they make it more personalized, right, in the buying journey? And that is where I talked about our SVDX, the customer experience platform, which is video collaboration, video commerce enabled solution that will help our customers in that journey of personalizing and delivering a superior customer experience in the buying journey, as well as in the after sales service that they have to deliver. The next set of things the customers look at is, you know, how do I do design engineering in a more collaborative way? You know, whether using AR, VR, or through design collaboration in B2B with their suppliers. And there again, you know, our solutions around our hybrid van solutions and some of our collaboration solutions will have a role to play. Third is, if you look at how do they produce, manufacture, get the supply chain logistics, all of their factories connected, the headquarters connected, that's the core connectivity platform that we have. And within the factory and within the campuses, you know, how do they ensure the workers' safety, asset tracking, and all of that? And there again, we have in India, a LoRa network-based IoT solution. And outside India, it will be largely the platform of worker safety and solution that we can offer. And in the after sales and the logistics part, you know, how do you track where the goods are? How do you embed? So when the customer's product is shipped outside and has to bootstrap and connect locally to be able to deliver the IoT, and that's where the move platform will become a lot more relevant to our customers. So as an example, when I look at the value chain of a manufacturing customer, in each of those areas, we have our products and offerings and solutions that we can offer to customers, and we have examples of these. Our go-forward ambition is that we will be able to put all of these together and see how we can be even more relevant to our customers in delivering a wholly stitched up solution rather than offering point products. And in that context, when we look at in today as to who owns the customers, especially when it involves whether it's the connectivity, whether it's the collaboration and so on, a lot of it is multiple players are involved, the cloud product OEMs, and the Cisco's, the Avaya's, the Microsoft's, and so on. And you have other players in that ecosystem, and we as a connectivity and other, you know, are also part of this ecosystem. Our ambition, as I said, going forward is, you know, we have to be one of the key enablers of this digital ecosystem and not just be part of the ecosystem, which is not very significant. Right? So we want to be a very key part of the enabler in the digital ecosystem. So that's our ambition. And we think we have all the capabilities and products and solutions, and some of the shifts that we would make in the company would help us to position this even more strongly going forward. Next slide, please. So what is our ambition? Our ambition is to achieve a profitable growth and become a leading digital ecosystem enabler in the eyes of our customers as well as amongst the industry. And how would we do that is I will explain in the next chart. So our strategy is in three parts, I'll explain. I mean, the goal eventually, is to get a healthy balance sheet, achieving a double-digit profitable growth, which if we do, and when we do, we will have a financial fitness. The growth plan is around the who, what, and the how, and we will explain. And as I said, our positioning will be as a digital ecosystem enabler. And internally, we will make some shifts, both structurally as well as driving through our signature campaign of drive through leadership behaviors. Next slide, please. So talking about the financials, we want to achieve the profitable data revenue growth, delivering a ROCE of 20% in the medium to long term, focus on double-digit EBITDA growth, and significant reduction in the net debt in the next 3 years. So that's what we have set up ourselves as goals for our financials. And in terms of the who, what, and the how. Next slide, please. I'll just dwell on each one of them a little bit before I go to the who. So in the who part, it's all about, you know, the segment, how we focus on the customer, and I will elaborate that a little bit more. And I already articulated how we want to be perceived by the customer. We want to be seen as problem solving and not selling product and not a product out company. In the what, you know, we have these products that we talked about, and we want to make a shift from products to platform. And in the how part is about, you know, how we are going to organize ourselves to deliver the superior customer experience, as well as our operating model that will deliver both the right cost structure as well as the experience for our customers. And underpinning all of that are certain key commitments that we are making, which I will cover in the subsequent slides. Next. So this is an essential part of the who. How do we deliver a superior customer experience? Segmentation, both in terms of the market segmentation. You know, India is a big market for us. International is big in terms of the potential. When we talked about the 145 billion network market that we talked about, India is about 1.3 to 1.5 billion, and the rest is in the international segment. And we see a big upside in both the markets. So we'll be very focused on the markets from a market perspective. The other aspect of segmentation is about the industries, and I will call out a couple of them subsequently. And the third element of the segmentation is, how do we focus on our customers? Deeper with fewer has always been the strategy of the company, and we are just giving it a lot more sharper focus in terms of how we are structuring ourselves, which is the next point, to deliver a single point of ownership to our named customers. We are putting a structure, which will be calling that as a customer success teams, that will have a single point of ownership across different products and solutions that we'll deliver to our customers. Third is about the customer service, the overall engagement that we have with customers to deliver on the outcomes that we promise to the customers. And the fourth is the internal transformation that we had embarked on, called Optimus, which delivers automation to eventually deliver the superior customer experience in the way we serve to our customers. So these are some key tenets of the who part of a strategy, essentially simplifying ourselves in the eyes of the customer, delivering a superior experience. Next slide, please. I talked about the segmentation. In segmentation, one segmentation I talked about is based on the industry segment. And I want to call out the media industry, which we have been focused on for the past several years. But, you know, I see this as a very, very good example of how we engage and the successes we have seen. You know, today we are delivering, as you can see, more than 5,000 live events globally, right? So be it, you know, various sporting events that we do, and we are one of the leaders in the motorsport racing, as you know, we deliver for, as you see here, the MotoGP and many other sporting events that you probably are already aware of. And similarly, we have other sporting events that we do, whether it's the sailing, cricket, and many, many other sporting events. So we are one of the leaders in delivering the sporting events in Europe, in India, in APAC, in the US. And today, we are delivering and enabling our customers for about 750 of these events to be remotely produced. So, you know, if you imagine a sporting event, so the last World Cup, for example, it was held in the UK, but the production of that was happening in India. Previously, the companies would have to send people to the stadium or close to the stadium to do all of those production. Today, the remote production is becoming more and more popular, which means that all of these events will be brought to one central location where they can do the remote production, and thereafter it will be distributed to the broadcasters, or it gets distributed to directly to the devices of consumers. And again, we have offerings both on both sides of being able to pull all of the events to a central location as well as to distribute these events. And there is a significant amount of upside there today. If you look at the 5,000 plus events, there is potential to take it up to 10,000 events. And similarly, the 750 remotely produced, many more and more customers will move towards the remote production as opposed to the old-fashioned, old ways of doing things. And this has gotten a significant upside of doing that as well. So I just wanted to briefly touch upon this, and we see a lot of expertise within the company. The customers and the market recognizes our expertise, and we have a very important niche in this segment. So this is one example of when we focus on an industry segment, what we can deliver. And we are creating another segment in auto OEM, largely to focus around our Move IoT platform on the back of the success with one of the OEMs that we have. And one of the critical thing we have to do is to replicate that. And we are creating and calling out a separate vertical focus unit to focus on this. So these are the two vertical focus and in the context of segmentation. And we can expand this in the future. But you see the direction of our travel through this. Next slide, please. In the what part of it, reimagining the platform, as I said, our efforts would be to shift from a product to a platform concept. And already we are seeing very many good examples of that in terms of our ability to combine our new IoT platform coupled with a NetFoundry platform, coupled with our CDN capabilities to deliver to our customers, both the edge capabilities as well as the MVNE capability and the IoT capability there. And the media example that I talked about brings together several platforms, as I said, the core connectivity, which is a very low latency, high performing network that we deliver, and combined with that, a video delivery network, which is on the edge. So it brings together our edge cloud capability as well as the video transport capability that we deliver. So that's another example of a platform that we have. And there are similar other platforms. As I said, customer experience platform that I talked about brings together our InstaCC platform, and combined with that, some of the video capability, collaboration capability, all of that comes together to deliver the customer experience platform. And some of the philosophies that we'll be focusing on developing products, key three design principles, from a CapEx efficiency, how will we enable a platform-based solution through those? And third is, how can we be agile? So all new product, new feature introduction will be in an agile principle. And it has to pass the test of the four business validation, scalability from a revenue point of view, profitability, its relevance to the industry and our customers and the technology shifts that are happening. And the fourth is, is a differentiation in terms of our product and service design as the customer would see it. Next slide, please. So putting all of these together, on the top, you see the customer drivers, and I spoke about it. The middle part are various portfolios that I talked about. The customer intimacy, customer experience, delivering that is going to be a crucial part. And to enable that, if we are calling out something as service wrap, this is something that we always have had in terms of our ability to deliver our network services or our InstaCC platform or all of these. But we are calling this out more explicitly and aggregating that to show that value that we can bring to our customers and give it its due importance, both within the company as well as in the eyes of the customer. So that is one thing that we're calling out. On the left-hand side, as I talked about, it's just not individual products, but it's about the platforms and delivering the experience. And our commitments all through this is one, sustainability will be a core at what we do, in how we do things, as well as in the products and solutions that we deliver, the customer must see that we are enabling them and helping them to become more sustainable. The second element of this is innovation. We have always had a very good innovation program, but we are giving it a lot more sharpness and focus, which we can see associated with where the needs are, where our investments are going, and what the results we need to deliver are. And the third element is about artificial intelligence. Again, From a data maturity standpoint, we had done an assessment internally and we are at a very good place. And we want to use that capability to harness the power of the data, both internally to deliver the efficiency, as well as to embed in our products to be able to deliver that to our customers. So these are the commitments and we are in the early stages of these, but that's the direction of travel for us. Next slide, please. Now, I think we, I emphasize the customer experience and in 2019, we had an NPS score of 55 and I'm very pleased to say that earlier this year when we did the survey in 2020, our score was 70, a huge jump that we saw. And this by all and any means is a very clear benchmark and we are extremely pleased. And this is one of our key differentiation in the market to be able to deliver to our enterprise customers. Thank you. I think with that, it wraps up my presentation and we'll be ready for questions. So Pratibha and I will take your questions.
Thank you, Lakshmi. Anyone who's interested in asking questions can click on the raise hand icon next to your name in the participant list, and we will take up the questions. We'll just wait for 1 minute for queue to assemble.
Yeah.
Okay, so first question is from the line of Sanjesh Jain from ICICI Securities. Sanjesh, you may please ask your question now.
Yeah, thanks Lakshmi for that detailed presentation. Couple of things. On the $145 billion revenue by way we participate today, what is the addressable market today and how do we see that addressable market expanding? And again, when we are talking of a double-digit growth, whereas industry probably remaining a flattish, that means we are looking at a significant market share gain there. So which are the area where you are confident that you will see a significant jump in the market share? That's one. Number two, on the product churn, what we talked about, where is traditional mostly or declining, and other areas like Cloud Connect and the value-added services are growing. How we expect to participate there, given that we have a significant dependence on traditional, which is declining, that means for us, the asking rate in participating on those services is significantly higher, given that we have an ambition to grow in a double digit. So these are the initial two questions. Thanks.
So the $145 billion world includes all connectivity, right? So what previously we would have classified as traditional and growth and so on. So that's the $145 billion market. As I said, the market opportunity, while the market is remaining static, we believe that customers will have to do a significant amount of network transformation. And there are some examples, and I alluded to a recent win that we had with a large medical equipment manufacturer in a global company. And that company has selected us to do the transformation of the network. So typically the customer pain points in the network are, you know, with the traditional network that they've had, whether it's the MPLS, the branches would be having either MPLS or internet connectivity. There's data centers would have some connectivity. They would have breakouts to the cloud from the branches or from the hub that they would have. This kind of a setup doesn't allow the customers to be very agile. So when they shift their applications from a data center to a cloud, and cloud is just not one cloud, right? So, you know, in different regions they are present, they might be going to a SaaS cloud, they might be going to their own application hosted on their private cloud and public cloud. As this migration happens, it is not just enough for the clouds to be connected, the cloud connectivity that we provide, but the enterprises connecting to them feel and find that they have to have an architecture which is more agile. And today the enterprises do not have that. So they are having to transform the network. That is one of the key drivers for the network transformation. The other, of course, is the cost. You know, they are probably on high cost MPLS and so on. Today, they can move to the internet based connectivity. And lastly, the software defined WAN. How do they do that? That overlay which helps them to be more application context aware, user aware, so that the connectivity can be delivered at the right quality and as well as the right price. So these are some of the key drivers for the network transformation. So that transformation has to take place. You know, and within an enterprise to do the transformation, there might be a smaller spike in the spend, and then you know the cost comes down. But that is what I meant by that 145 billion world. In the long run, it might look to be the same, but that change and the churn will happen. And for us, the opportunity is to go and participate in that transformation is the opportunity. Given that, you know, today, you know, in that 145 billion world in international markets, so India is about 1.3 billion, as I said, probably growing to about 1.5 in the international market. Our participation, while it is there, we have a tremendous amount of white space that exists. And that is why I'm calling out that as an opportunity for us to grow. Sandesh,
got it. So
the question. And the second part of the traditional, you know, yes, there are certain things within traditional, but I do believe traditional, you know, will you know, can. And you know, for example, within that, you know, we are trying to redesign something based on demand and so on and so forth. So you know, that has still got you know room left for growth, even though one might call it as traditional. And in the picture that I showed you on the enterprise side and the OTT side and so on, you know, there are traditional as well as the new network transformation that happens. In the new world, I wouldn't see the split exactly as traditional and growth. I think that my view would be I want to look at enterprises more holistically. And if they are taking an Ethernet, if they are taking an MPLS, they're taking an Internet, I don't want to split that as, you know, how much of Ethernet they take. Is it traditional or is it new? Right? That's not the way I'm going to see, and that's not the way I see things. If you look at more customer out, customer has got a network, how can I help them to modernize? And in that, they will use different products and solution of ours, and we will participate in that transformation.
And if I can just leave a data point with you, Sanjesh, in FY20, our enterprise business has grown by 13%, right? 16% growth from India and 11-12% international. And as Lakshmi rightly pointed out, that while we are going to look at data holistically, but having said that, and if I still go back and to your question of, you know, if traditional is coming down and cloud connect, et cetera, is going to grow, how do you expect double digit? Even if you look at FY19, if I look at the breakup of how, where the growth came from, a large chunk of our revenue did come from growth services. And growth services actually gave almost, if I remember correctly, a close to 400 crores of revenue. While traditional, we're about 375-376 crores. So that's really what makes us confident that we can deliver on double-digit growth.
Got it, Pratibha. Thanks. Lakshmi, just first a little bit of clarification on that, on the my first question. When we are talking of double-digit growth, there is two phases to it, right? One is market share gain, and one is expansion of our footprint itself in the market. So just wanted to understand on the second part, how is our footprint in the market going to expand, given that we are already present in 98% of global GDP? Are we significantly present in that $145 billion kind of a market, or our presence is restricted there?
Yeah. So when we talk about a double-digit data growth, it is not just on the network, right? I mean, we are also including our other collaboration and other services in that growth. So that is one point I want to make. And to your question on the international market and our participation, yes, I think that is one of our strong points and has always been our strong points, that when customers look for global connectivity of multiple regions to be able to connect them, our participation there can be very, very strong due to the fact that we enable the global connectivity and we are present in across different countries. You're right, you know, there are certain things, like if you look at only an in-country operation, let's say like the US, our connectivity and reach and the capillarity within that will not be the same as a large incumbent there. Having said that, if there are international customers, we will be very strong in participation and in the deal that I alluded to. You know, we won against a very large US headquartered company. So our ability to compete and win there is definitely there. But if a company is concentrated very heavily in just one region, then our ability to compete as of now isn't there. But with some of our newer solutions like the ISO internet and our ability to claim the internet, we can definitely still disrupt there.
Yeah, got it, Lakshmi. Just one last question from my side. Till last year, we used to share the order book. Now I understand that we don't share it. But just wanted to understand, how is the visibility on the growth given our sales funnel or order book, how confident we are in terms of delivering a strong double-digit growth in next 2 years?
Yeah, Sandesh, you know, all I'm talking about now is a mid to long-term plan, right? So there's the direction of travel for 5 years. The upside that I'm talking about and the direction that we are setting ourselves to move on is all that. And I don't think you can look at, you know, last quarter's order book and extrapolate our growth for the next 3 years. That is not the intent of this presentation. And the reason why the order book thing, I wanted to get more clarity on the linkage between the order book and the growth, right? Because we have a product mix which is very varied. Some products are usage based, and some products are, you know, based on a fixed MRC that the customers pay. And given that product mix are different, the order book, how it is calculated and how that translates to revenue are all very different. So until we gain more clarity and we are able to see the linkages very clearly, we decided not to share that information.
No, that I appreciate. Like,
yeah.
Just my question was only that in our presentation we have given a target that we will achieve a 20% ROC in next 3 years.
Yes.
Just wanted to get a comfort on how is the order book and how do we see and how much confidence we have in terms of reaching that.
I think
that was the only.
I'm presenting a mid to long term plan, and we are very confident of it. I mean, I think we have the confidence both stemming from the strength of the product and solution, stemming from what I have heard from customers. Obviously, we'll have to execute. There are multiple shifts that we have to make, and they are not necessarily easy shifts to make. But we have some early signs of success. But we have to mobilize the entire company behind making this shift. And we are quite confident of making our travel towards that direction in a very sure-footed way.
Yeah, thanks, Lakshmi. I got more questions, but I will come in queue for you. Thank you, and best wishes.
Thank you,
Sanjesh. The next question is from Vivekanand Subbaraman of Ambit Research. Vivek, you can ask the question now.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. My question pertains to the market structure of this $145 billion market. You gave some color, Lakshmi, on the the spend percentage of spend that happens in cross country operations. You have a much better right to win than some of the others, whereas in country related spends like in the US, you lack the reach and capability. How should we think about the market share of the two sets of players? One is players like you who provide network services and then have laddered up to new solutions and are stitching together bundled services versus say integrated telcos and system integrators. You had a slide where you mentioned about being at the center of these things. I would like to understand that better? And can you also talk about whether you feel an integrated solution would work better vis-a-vis a modular solution, let's say customers opting for, you know, cherry picking their own cloud provider, cybersecurity, and so on. Thanks.
Okay. On the market structure of the 145 billion, I just want to, as you rightly picked up, our ability to compete in the for a multinational companies which are spread across multiple regions is that much more stronger. And when we serve those multinational companies, we do serve them in their countries as well, right? So in the US and in Europe and others. And Europe, by definition, is an assembly of different countries anyway. So we have many of our large network transformation deals have happened in Europe, and Asia Pacific is again similarly multiple countries and the APAC region. The way our customers see it and the way we see it. So in each of these areas, we think our ability to compete is quite strong. So that is one. I don't know if that answers the question on the market structure, but if you ask me how many customers would be domestic only customers. So if I take, UK as an example and say Sainsbury's as a retailer there, would we be able to compete strongly on the network transformation for them? Not holistic network transformation, probably not. There are aspects like, for example, with NetFoundry and a few other capabilities that we can address. But there are companies and banks which are multinational and spread across regions, then our ability to compete there is strong. And I don't have the split readily of the 145 of the example I gave of an example of the Sainsbury's versus somebody else. But, you know, all I can say is, even if we were to take only 50% of that, the upside is there. And we are not still very significant in that play. Our game will be to position ourselves as a network transformation player overlaid with security, and our ability to compete and win is what we see as the potential upside. Even if you were to take only a smaller percentage, if I remove that for customers who are only having in-country operations, right? So, I hope that answers your first question. The second question on integrated play is, I believe, for example, when we do the network transformation, there are efforts by some companies who say, the underlay can be provided by somebody. I will do the overlay with somebody. Then I will have somebody else for network security. And somebody else to see how we can stitch all of these together. And we believe that providing a complete end-to-end joined up solution is a lot more beneficial for our customers to deliver on the promise of, giving them an agile architecture, which is flexible, secure, and cost efficient, right? So, that's how we see it. So I think the integrated play would be important, at least in that sort of network plus portfolio that I talked about. Similarly, when I look at the customer experience, and I talked about our InstaCC platform, which integrates with the CRM, which integrates with social and hosted on the cloud. And there again, we will stitch together capabilities of our the MMX messaging capabilities, some of our video capabilities, all of that to deliver a video collaboration and a video commerce capability to our customers. So that will also be stitched together. And I called out a service wrap, which is a capability which will stitch all of these products and solutions together to deliver to our customers. So I think bringing all of that together, the customers will see a better value proposition in my mind. Of course, there'll be customers who would want to unpick and do that, but our job and effort would be to show that 1 + 1 can be 3 rather than 1 + 1 being 1.5 or 2.
Vivek? So there was one more question I had within this complex discussion where do we stand versus system integrators or globally integrated telcos like Verizon, Vodafone, etc. And what makes us unique to win a greater share of this 145 billion market than those players?
Yeah, in the recent Everest report, you know, we have been put on the leader for the network transformation. The capability that we bring in that space is, as I said, you know, our global network is architected, in what we call as an agile architecture, to be able to help the customers to connect to different parts of the cloud, different clouds in different regions. We have a solid SD-WAN capability embedded within our own network, as well as an overlay that we can deliver as a managed services to our customers. We have a service wrap capability that can stitch all of this together, and combined with that, the security that we talk about, right? As people move out to cloud, how do we overlay this? So all of that capabilities combined together with our network presence globally, the way it is architected, and for the enterprise specifically, that we can deliver this as an agile architecture, and the overlay capabilities that we have, and the service capability, and the security capability. This is what our customers look for. And I think some of the recent wins gives us the confidence that we can position ourselves strongly. Now, having said that, if you look at, we are not an SI per se. We don't play in the application space, but in the space that we play around network, around the adjacent areas of security, how do you transform it and how do you deliver that? Combined with that underlay of network, which is hugely important, even if you have an SD-WAN on top, that holistic knowledge and the deep expertise that we have will position us very uniquely in the market.
Understood. Thanks. I'll come back in the queue.
Yeah.
Thanks, Vivek. The next question is from the line of Mayank Babla of TCG AMC. Mayank, you may ask your question now.
Thank you for taking my question. Can you hear me? Sorry.
Yes, we can. Yeah.
So actually, my question is regarding this these platforms, Move IT and the media platform. So who would be our peers in this space, and how are we placed versus them, vis-a-vis them?
Yeah. In the Move IoT space, I would like to think we are very unique, because it's a combination of certain capabilities that we bring, right? So what one would call as the MVNE platform that we bring, and combined with that, we bring the eSIM capability, the eSIM hub capability. And there are different players in the eSIM world that one might be there. So with the eSIM hub capability, for example, you know, we can be a very carrier agnostic place. So what we are doing for a large OEM or the airlines, for example, when the airline crew, you might have seen, they carry their own devices, maybe the iPads and others to service. But when they go to a country, it automatically boots up and connects to whichever carriers that would deliver the best service that we would have configured alongside with our customers, right? And it can dynamically switch from one to another as well, depending on where they are. If they are in the airport, if the quality there of one is better than, you know, when they go to the hotel, maybe somebody else is better, or based on cost. So they dynamically be able to switch. All of that is the capability. And so there we can, while we have relationships with about 160 carriers around the world, we are fairly agnostic. And that is fairly unique to us in the way that we offer the solution. And the eSIM hub part and the intelligence that we are building is also fairly unique. Now, other telcos would also have some capability of the other in this, but what we have, I would like to think, is fairly unique. And in the eSIM, there are multiple other competitors. On the MVNE side, also there are multiple other global telcos who can play in that space.
Sure. And so my second question is
on the media. You asked in media again. You know, as I said, you know, we there are you know there are the competition with the large global telcos there, be it Telstra's or the BT's in the world or others. But again, our unique capability is our deep understanding of the media ecosystem, the relationships that we have built with large amount of sporting federations, and the experience that we have gained to deliver a low latency product, a 4K video quality, right, with very low latency, to deliver that network that we have engineered and the solutions we have engineered are fairly unique. So all of that capability puts us in a fairly good position to serve the media segment more effectively.
Okay. Thank you, sir. My second question was regarding the security space. So I just wondered if you could help me understand. So even TCS was recently put in the leaders quadrant for security services. How are we placed? Do we complement them in this space, or?
So the security, as I said, we, you know, I call it as part of the network plus plus. You know, we come from an adjacency of network, right? So some of the products and solutions and the capability that we bring, we don't come from an application background. But having said that, we have a strong portfolio of complete security offering in India. Internationally, we complement them, and internationally, our positioning is more adjacent to the network in our security offerings.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mayank. The next question is from the line of Nimit Sana.
That's all from.
Thank you, Mayank. The next question is from the line of Nimit Tana of CWC Advisor. Nimit, you may please ask your question now.
Thanks, Supul. Hi, Lakshmi. I just had two questions. One is that the net promoter score from 55 to 70 is actually is very incredible in a year, especially when you take into context what you said on your con call of higher participation by 6%. Wanted to understand, you know, in a short period to see such a big jump, what was some of the key tweaks that were made? And, you know, where did it come from? What were the drivers for that? And my second question is, you know, to try and get a better understanding of, you know, the potential of TCOM and TCS on a going forward basis. What is the current tradition? And, you know, you spoke about digital having the three legs, and they are a very important ESA, extremely, you know, well integrated with global enterprises. How do you see that relationship going forward, especially, you know, given the focus of a one Tata policy? Thank you.
Yeah. So, firstly, on the NPS, you know, it is just not the effort of the last 6 months. There has been a program that has been on what we call as a customer success management. It's partly tweaking our structure to be able to dedicate a team of people who are focused on our customers as part of a deeper with fewer strategy. And that is that has played out to a very large extent in the success of the program, and the result is there to see. The second, I also think in the last few months, particularly in the early stages of the COVID, and we did the survey in the midst of the COVID, and one of the concerns we had was, you know, the customers are going to be busy, we don't know what experience they would have as they all struggle for, you know, their own business continuity plans. But then we nonetheless went ahead and did that because that is the time we normally do, and we didn't want to just shift it because of what is happening now. And I must say our teams had done a terrific job in terms of responding to our customers' requests to quickly enable them to work from home, you know, in providing some of the solutions which will bring them secure connectivity from home, as well as maybe shifting some of the call center agents who had to work from home to quickly come up with solutions to enable that. Or, you know, large enterprises, as a result of the increase in the cloud collaboration, they had to increase some of the capacity, and we were able to help them to increase the capacity very, very quickly. The underlying reasons being, you know, as I said before, the way we have engineered our networks, as well as the service orientation and the customer centricity that our employees and our teams have. All of that has contributed. So there might be an extra point that we might have gained during the COVID because of the experience that we gave to our customers. But it's a combination of several things, a program that has been running for the last 1 year that has delivered these results. So that's the first question. And your second question on the potential of collaboration. You know, we have a fairly strong collaboration. We've always had a good collaboration with SIs, particularly with TCS. And we, and as you rightly call, the one Tata and looking at synergies and scale as a group team, we are calling out certain areas where the collaboration can be stronger, and the teams are working in many of those key pillars as to how we can complement each other during the network transformation, how we can complement the unified collaboration space, for example, in enabling large enterprise customers to implement and adapt Microsoft Teams, for example, or any other collaboration platform that our customers might choose. Now, how do we strongly collaborate in this area? So we have a we have a program as to how we will collaborate, a clear understanding, so that we can take it to market.
Thank you.
Thank you, Nimit. We are almost out of time. Actually, we are already out of time, so we'll take the last question. The last question is from the line of Ali Asghar, Shakir from Motilal Oswal. Ali, you may ask your question now.
Hello?
Ali? Ali, you will have to unmute yourself. We have unmuted you from the back end. There seems to be...
Hello?
Yes, Ali, we can hear you now.
Yeah. Am I audible now?
Yes, yes.
Yes, you are.
Okay. Thanks for the opportunity. I have a couple of questions. One is on your, you know, CapEx trends. So given that the kind of, you know, I mean, foray we have in multiple of these segments, you know, and growth that we are targeting, double-digit growth, just wanted to understand what is our CapEx guidance. And related to that, you know, now that we have indicated that we are looking to, you know, significantly reduce our debt, you know, also wanted to understand if there is any, you know, upward bias on this CapEx and, you know, probably acquisition of TTSL. Which could probably disrupt this, you know, debt reduction target.
Okay, on CapEx, I don't know what guidance. We have stated that you know, I'm factoring a similar level of ongoing investments that we would have to make. A large part of our CapEx goes to, you know, maintaining our current network infrastructure, both the submarine as well as the terrestrial infrastructure that we have. And the other part goes towards, you know, expansion of the network or some of the growth products and platforms that we invest in, and some of them are more customer specific capex that we do when we win the deals. So the overall envelope we believe will continue to be the same. Obviously, how we invest, where we invest, some of the internal processes that we are looking at would fine-tune that, but the overall envelope would remain the same. The second question, I can't answer that. I mean, there is nothing, I mean, all of these strategies and plans are based on, you know, organic, and, you know, nothing either in terms of, you know, not factoring in any other one-off that you might have.
All right. And the second question is on, you know, I mean, just talking a little bit about the segment parts of your growth and innovation businesses. So you mentioned in detail about, you know, the opportunity in that $145 billion market. Within that, if I look at it on a segment-wise basis, wanted to understand, is the growth going to accelerate in the growth segment significantly, or should we assume that to be sort of in mid-teens and, you know, more margin-led improvement that should drive profit growth, particularly from the point of view that, we have reached a decent scale and now, you know, there could be a lot of monetization of the OPEX that we have already done. Also related to that, on the innovation side, I just wanted to understand at what scale do we expect innovation segment to start turning profitable?
So, Pratibha, do you want to take that question?
Sure, Lakshmi. So I'm actually going to start from your last question on the innovation service. The way we look at it is, and Lakshmi pointed out that we are now looking at our entire data portfolio in a more integrated way. We are not focusing on products per se, but bringing them together to have a platform play. Having said that, the moment innovation touches a revenue of about 125 to 150 million is when we would start to see that portfolio turn EBITDA positive, given that we are still investing in that portfolio. Again, coming back to your point on growth, I think I pretty much covered it, that we're looking at a more integrated play. It is a portfolio that, as you rightly said, is now a large base. And the fact that we've called out that we are looking at our entire data portfolio to grow a double digit in medium to long term speaks for itself, that obviously the momentum is going to come from that growth portfolio.
Also, the 145 billion we talked about is only in the network space, right? The collaboration space, the other spaces are distinctly different.
I know. I'm just going to touch upon, I was just, since he had talked about 145 billion growth, and again, I think on the network, Lakshmi, you had very rightly said that the opportunity is really going to come from transformation. And that is what gives us the confidence that we would have the growth momentum.
Got it. Actually, my question was more from the point of view that, while I understand we are looking for a double digit growth in the data business, but if it would be coming from probably particular product categories which are still in the nascent investment phase, then is there a risk that that kind of revenue growth may probably not translate to stronger profitability?
No, I think the goal is to say we are going to grow profitably, and I laid out the selection of the key pillars tested based on whether it can scale in revenue terms and can deliver the margins that we expect to deliver. So the six key pillars called out, it will have to pass all those tests that I talked about. So we are quite confident that we can continue to grow and grow profitably. And as I said, the upside remains, in the medium to long term, is what these are the tests that we have done in terms of the market potential, as well as what is the need in our customer base. And we believe that those six key pillars that we've called out does have the upside potential. And as you said, some of our products within that, which are in the early stages and have not turned EBITDA positive, as Pratibha pointed out, and that those are the evaluation that we did to see, can it become profitable as we scale? And when we were satisfied that the answer is yes, is when we call this out as six key pillars.
And I think what specifically that Lakshmi did touch upon in his presentation when he said, how are we going to now look? Profitability and scalability will be the two parameters that we would consider. And all these growth pillars have passed that test, so they are low in terms of capital intensity. And obviously, we're also going to get now economies of scale when it comes to our OPEX as revenue ramps up in some of these pillars.
Got it. This is useful. I have just last one follow-up on innovation. You mentioned $125 million kind of revenue will make you profitable, reach a break-even. Could you share any timelines, and during that period, if our losses in the business should be at the similar level, or it should sort of grow or reduce from here?
Yeah, Ali, we don't give guidance, but I have given you the, you know, the way forward, and we're gonna hit.
Fair enough.
Yeah, but I mean, we don't give formal guidance.
I understand. Thanks. Thanks a lot, Pratibha. Thanks, Lakshmi.
Thank you, Ali. This brings us to the end of the event. I'll now hand over to Lakshmi for his closing comments. Thank you, everyone.
Okay. Thank you, everyone, for your patiently listening to the last hour plus. As I said, you know, we are quite confident of our medium to long-term potential, both in terms of the upsides available in the marketplace that I explained in each of the areas, and our ability to execute to get that potential tapped into to hit our goals. So with that, I would like to close and thank you all for joining us today.
Thank you, Lakshmi. Thank you, everyone, for joining. You may now disconnect the call. Thank you.